Hi everyone, welcome back to my videos on discrete-time Markov chain. Last time we proved this very important theorem that states that if a discrete-time Markov chain is irreducible, then it's going to be positive recurrent if and only if it has a unique stationary distribution. And in today's video, I'm going to give you examples, an example of application of this theorem. So there are really two cases to consider. If your process is irreducible and finite, then you automatically have positive recurrence. That's what we are going to do today. We are going to look at an example of this type. And in this case, you know directly that there must be a unique stationary distribution, and you just have to solve the system by p equals pi to find the stationary distribution. Things are a little bit more complicated if your process is irreducible but infinite, meaning the state space is infinite, in which case the existence of a stationary distribution is not guaranteed. And so in this case, you again have to solve the system by p equals pi, but then make sure that you end up with solution where the total mass of the measure you find is strictly positive and less than infinity to eventually deduce positive recurrence. So in the example we are going to see today, we assume that a kid called Thomas plays a video game that has five different levels. The levels increase in difficulty, so which is modeled by the fact that the probability that Thomas is going to succeed in completing level I is given by p at the power I, where p is between 0 and 1. So indeed, the probability of success is going to decrease. And applying the theory we saw last time, we can in fact find the expected number of levels Thomas will play before he loses a game. So that's the goal of this problem. So let's see what we can do writing some equations. So to solve this problem, the natural Markov chain that we can introduce is the process that is going to keep track of the level Thomas is playing at time n. So I'm going to write this. Let's call xn the level Thomas is playing at time n. So here we have to be careful, time is not the actual time, but it's just, let's think that, so he starts with playing level 1, it's going to take him some time, and then at the next time step he's going to play level 2 in case he succeeds in level 1, and if he doesn't, then he's going to play again level 1 and so on. So that's how we count time, in fact. And so you see that if we introduce this process, we can easily write the transition probabilities. In fact, I'm also going to draw the directed graph so that we see what's going on. And so eventually we have, because there are five levels, there are also five states. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And we know that, so this is level 1, this is level 5. And we know that when Thomas plays level 1, he's going to reach level 2 at the next time step with probability p, because he succeeds level 1 with probability p at the power 1. So we can go from 1 to 2 with probability p. Similarly, we go from 2 to 3 with probability p squared, then here with probability p cubed, and then here with probability p at the power 4. Okay? And at the opposite, from level 1, you go back to level 1 with probability 1 minus p. But from level 2, you are going to go back to level 1 with probability 1 minus p squared, and so on. Okay? And from, so something to notice is that level 5 is the last level, and so after level 5 there is no other level after that. So in any case that Thomas wins or loses at level 5, he's going to go back to level one eventually. So you have an exception for the last transition. This one occurs with probability one. And so from that, we can get our transition matrix. And so it's given by a 5x5 matrix. So from level one, you go to level two with probability p, and you stay at level one with probability one minus p. So we have a one minus p here, then p 0, 0, 0. Okay, then same story for level two, you have a one minus p square, 0, p square, 0, 0. Notice that now there is a zero on the diagonal because if you play something else than level one, either you win and you go to the next level, or you lose and you go back to level one. Then we continue, one minus p cube, 0, 0, p cube, 0, one minus p four, 0, 0, 0, p four. And then here we have this exception where from level five, we always go back to level one. And so here we have only zeros here and a one at the end. Okay, no, sorry. It's the other way around. We cannot stay at level five, but we go back to level one. So this is the transition matrix. So now that we have our transition matrix, we can find the stationary distribution by solving the system pi p equals pi. But first, let's really think of what is the question exactly. So the question is, how many levels in average Thomas is going to play until he loses. So this means that, let's say at time zero, he's playing level one, and then at time two, let's say at the next time step, he's back at level one, in which case he played only one level, or he goes to level two and then loses while playing level two, in which case he played two levels, and so on. So what we really need to do here is compute, in fact, the expected number of time step until he's back to level one, okay? Starting from level one. So in fact, the question, even if it might not look like this when we read the question, what is the expected number of levels Thomas is going to play at each game? In fact, what we really need to compute is what we call the mean recurrence time at state one, okay, that we saw in the previous video. So the goal is really to do this, it's to compute the expected value starting from one of t1, okay? That's the question. And the theory tells us that this mean recurrence time should be equal to 1 divided by pi 1, where pi is the unique stationary distortion. So now let me go back a little bit to the theory. Here we have a Markov chain that is clearly, we see from the directed graph representation, you have a cycle going from 1 to 5 and back to 1. So that means that indeed the process is irreducible. Clearly, the state space is finite, so by one of the theorems we saw last time, we can say that irreducibility and finiteness of the state space implies positive recurrence. And so positive recurrence guarantee, and together with irreducibility again, together they guarantee the existence and uniqueness of a stationary distribution. So with no calculation, the theory of Markov chain is going to tell us that the set of solution pi p equals pi should be a one-dimensional vector space. Okay, so indeed, if there is a unique solution to this system, then because zero is always a solution, that would mean that pi equals zero is the only solution. This would contradict the fact that there is a unique stationary distribution. Again, a distribution should have the sum of its coefficients equal to 1. So the theory tells us that the set of solutions to the system pi p equals pi should be a one-dimensional vector space. And then I'm not going to talk too long about that, but because it's about linear algebra, but hopefully you know about linear algebra, and you know that if the set of solution of like linear system attached to this matrix is a one-dimensional vector space, then that means that we can ignore one of those equations to solve the system. So that's one trick that you can use often. The theory of Markov chain sometimes tells you, if the state space here is finite, sometimes tells you that there must be a unique solution. And from that, you can deduce that the set of solution is a one-dimensional vector space, which means that there is no uniqueness of the set of solution. Okay, even if there is a unique stationary solution, there is a uniqueness of the stationary distribution, but the set of invariant or stationary measure corresponds to a one-dimensional vector space, so you can ignore one of the equations when you want to solve the system. And so here, obviously, what makes sense is to ignore this column here. That's the most complicated one, and so to solve the system, we are going to ignore this one. So, that's one thing I wanted to say. Second thing I want to point out is the fact that each time you want to compute in any prime about Markov chain, the mean recurrence time at a state, don't try to compute this mean recurrence time directly. What you should do instead, because it's much easier, it's first to prove that the process is positive recurrent. And then if not, then that means that this recurrence time, mean recurrence time, is infinite. And indeed, if you have uniqueness, if you have positive recurrence, then you have existence of the stationary distribution. You can find the stationary distribution, and from that you deduce only after the mean recurrence time. Okay? So that's basically some recipe you have to remember for any kinds of prime about mean recurrence time. And so now we are ready to solve our system. So if you look at, if you want to solve pi p equals pi, so from the second column you get that p times pi 1 should be equal to pi 2. Then from the third column, you get p squared pi 2 must be equal to pi 3. Then p cubed pi 3 equals pi 4. And finally, p 4. Pi 4 should be equal to pi 5. Okay, so from this set of equations, you see they are kind of defined recursively. So things are not very difficult. You have pi 1 as a function of pi 2. So you can express basically pi 2 as a function of pi 1, and then pi 3 as a function of pi 2 that we know as a function of pi 1, and so on. So eventually, the solution to this system is not very complicated, and you get basically that in, so let's say pi 2 is equal to p pi 1. I'm just going to rewrite them in the reverse order, and then you have that pi 3 is equal to p squared times p pi 1. So p cube pi 1, then for pi 3, pi 4, sorry, for pi 4, you get that this is p cube times this one, so it's p at the power 6 times pi 1, and then finally for pi 5, we get p at the power 4 times this one, so it's p at the power 10 times pi 1. And from this, so this defines your one-dimensional vector space. the set of solutions to the system pi p equals pi is going to be the one-dimensional vector space generated by the vector 1, p, p cube, p6, p10. Okay, so eventually you obtain that pi is proportional, in fact, to the vector, so 1, p, p cube, p6, p at the power 10. And of course, you just divide by the sum of the coordinates to get the actual stationary distribution. So 1 plus p plus p cube plus p6 plus p10. And now you can answer this question. So this tells you that the theory tells you that the expected number of levels Thomas is going to play when he plays the game once is going to be equal to so this quantity, which is 1 over pi 1. So this is 1 over pi 1. And if you look at the value, that's going to be equal to 1 plus p plus p cube plus p6 plus p10. And this concludes this point. So maybe one little observation here to see that indeed the result is consistent with our intuition. You see that if p equals 0, for instance, meaning that both levels are just impossible to complete, then you see that this expression is equal to 1. And yes, indeed, that means that each time Thomas is going to play, he's going to constantly lose level 1. And so in average, he's indeed going to play one level only. If at the opposite, the game is extremely easy and Thomas is going to complete all the levels extremely easily each time he plays the game, then we expect the expected number of levels he's going to play at each game is going to be 5, is going to just complete all the levels. And yes, indeed, if p is equal to 1, you get this is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay? So that's consistent with our intuition. But of course, now you have some very precise expression that tells you indeed the expected number of levels is going to play for all possible values of p between 0 and 1.